Welcome to the Skeptic Zone, the podcast from Australia for science and reason.
And now we bring you a story of woe and dread. Yeah, my computer broke. I pressed the on button, click, 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 and it didn't fire up. Oh no, it had all the Zone files on it for this week. So what do? I resurrect my Windows 2000 machine, clunk, 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 sort of whirs into life. I can reconstruct the show from the files that I've been sent, and here it is. You may notice the levels are slightly out this week. That's because I haven't got all my lovely utilities I normally have to even out the show. Please bear with it. I hope you don't mind. It's Richard Saunders here with you once again for The Skeptic Zone, show number 70. 70? Oh, wow. For the 19th of February, 2010. What an interesting show we have for you today. We have an interview with Matthew Baxter from the Rocky Mountain Paranormal Society. Interesting stuff. All sorts of investigations up there. Rocky Mountains, I wonder if they ever come across Bigfoot. Listen on for the interview coming up shortly. After that, we have a little interlude with our good friend George Shrub. And then it's the return of Dr. Stefan Soyka. He's going to tell us all about doctors without medicine. That should be interesting. A couple of little notes to look out for also while you're surfing the internet. Please check out Dr. Rachie's blog, The Skeptic's Book of Poo-Poo, or The Skeptic's Book, and also The Zoner's blog. You can reach both of those from our website at skepticzone.tv. Another interesting site that's been brought to my attention is skepticalscience.com, where you can download an iPhone app all about global warming. Questions answered, all sorts of things. iPhone app for global warming. People like you and me who are interested in the topic. Worth checking out. Now, let me say how impressed I've been lately with our colleagues in New Zealand and their excellent work in battling homeopathy. Why don't you check out a podcast down there called The Completely Unnecessary Skeptical Podcast, and that's http://thecusp.org.nz. And while you're sort of looking around that area in the world, check out the New Zealand Skeptics, which is skeptics.org.nz. Vicky Hyde is certainly one of our heroines down there. I've been having a lot of fun lately putting up some of my TV appearances on YouTube, and my YouTube channel is called Skeptic Zone Podcast. Over the last few years, I've been popping in and out of TV, debating various people, crop circles, ghosts, ghost photography, that sort of stuff. And finally, those people in Victoria, in Mildura, there's an interesting new Skeptics in the Pub starting up, the Sunraysia Skeptics in the Pub. The first meeting is on the 2nd of March, 6 p.m. at O'Malley's Irish Pub. Why is it always Irish pubs? In Mildura. Check out the website at designatedthinkers.blogspot.com. And thanks to Des Horwood for that little piece of information. All right, I can't wait to listen to this interview myself, so sit back, grab that champagne, and enjoy this episode of The Skeptic Zone.
I'm Carly Sturgis, and I'm talking to Matthew Baxter. Matthew Baxter, or just Baxter as he's referred to, has backgrounds in IT, design, photo, video editing, and paranormal research. He's been actively researching the paranormal for over 15 years, dealing with claims involving UFOs, ghosts, demonology, fraud detection, psychology, and cleansings, amongst other areas. As a member of the Rocky Mountain Paranormal Research Society in Denver, Colorado, Baxter approaches the research and findings with a scientific mind first. In addition, he is the co-host of the Warning Radio Show.
Thank you so much for joining me again, Baxter, because I tried doing this interview before and I lost it, and I feel awful before. I think there's a gremlin in the system.
I can certainly investigate that for you.
Good. Okay. Tell us all about what you investigate.
Well, we are a little different than other paranormal teams. And by we, I mean Rocky Mountain Paranormal Research Society. Mm. Most teams go in with the intention of going to catch that ghost or whatever phenomena it is that they're looking at. We tend to investigate the claim rather than, you know, anything like a ghost. You know, you can't really go in and investigate a ghost if you don't even know if it actually exists. So we investigate what people claim and then look at what might have caused them to make the claim. And so that approach really helps us with keeping an open mind about the possibilities.
Now, you've been keeping an open mind for a long time. You told me you've been doing UFO investigations in particular since 1993.
That's when I really started with paranormal research. And I did start off with the UFO International Association was the group that I had originally joined. And then I dropped out of that and started doing the ghost hunting side of things a little bit more prominently in late 2001, early 2002. And it was very shortly after that that I joined Rocky Mountain Paranormal Research Society. When you're doing something like researching the paranormal, you have to be aware that there's a lot of dangers involved. And I'm not talking about the kind of dangers where, oh, you should surround yourself with a bubble of white light and all that kind of stuff. I'm talking about a lot of the places that you're encouraged to go to investigate are old properties. Oh. And there can be a lot of dangers in just wandering around in places you probably shouldn't be. So really, if you're going to be doing something like that, don't do it alone. You know, go to investigate the legend of some old bridge somewhere, and there's just too many things that can happen. I mean, you can fall and hurt yourself, and there you are all by yourself. So it's a really good idea to make sure you join a group, and then you can pool your knowledge and resources and intuitions and all these different things. And I don't mean intuitions as in being an intuitive, otherwise known as a psychic, but more of your gut feelings. You know, if you feel like maybe we ought to not be here because, you know, the police are on their way, you know, that's a good intuition to have.
Yeah, I read on your site that you were the one who owned an EMF detector, and that was a big factor in being a member.
Well, before I had joined my first ghost group, I did feel that I needed to get some equipment. Mm. So I purchased a tri-field natural EMF detector and, you know, digital cameras and various things like that, you know, the security video cameras and all that kind of stuff. So when I joined my first group, they were much more of the believer mindset. Mm. And they really were at odds with this other gentleman in town that was a very large skeptic. He ran his own group, and he was a very big skeptic, and he kept throwing out things like Occam's razor at them.
How dare
you? I know. He was just being a complete bastard. And since I came in with this scientific device, they thought, he's got a science mind. He'll be perfect to battle against this evil person. And this evil person turned out to be Brian Bonner, head of the Rocky Mountain Paranormal Research Society. And oddly enough, after I kept debunking the evidence of the team I was on, they kicked me out. Well, I went and had a discussion with this horrible Brian Bonner and found out that I am every bit as horrible as he is.
Oh, that's good. Unity in horribleness. I mean, what else can you ask for? Yeah. How did your paranormal radio show begin?
Well, actually, I was at one point watching this movie that had just come out called 1408, Stephen King movie. And in this movie, the main character is a very skeptical gentleman, but he loves to do paranormal investigation and then report back what he finds to a large number of people via books he would write.
That's a very encouraging role model, isn't it, to have in the media?
Yes, yes. So it just struck me that what we do as a paranormal research team is different than what everybody else is doing. So I decided at that moment that we needed to start an internet radio show so we could actually let people know what it is we do, what our viewpoints are, and maybe educate them on some of the mistakes they're making. And it was originally focused for the rest of the paranormal community. You know, is try to bring some of them in and educate them as to some of the mistakes they were making. It turned out that over time, we had had some guests on, such as James Randi and James Underdown and DJ Grothy, along with Lloyd Arbach, who is a big paranormal investigator here, and several others. And we really began to realize that we enjoyed talking to the skeptics far more than we did the paranormal believers. Oh. And in fact, we would have most of our hair pulled out at the end of the paranormal believer interviews. And we would find ourselves overjoyed and in great moods after we had interviewed skeptics. So needless to say, we don't interview the believers anymore. We try to reach out to them and talk to them and do as much, you know, community outreach and grassroots type education as we can. But we tend to interview people that we like now because, you know, it's our show. We're not getting paid for it. So we're going to make sure we have fun.
That's a nice challenge to the grumpy skeptic stereotype as well, by having a fun show that talks to skeptics, isn't it?
Yes, because it is such a prevalent stereotype. And I think that stereotype was started by both James Randi and Joan Nickel, but it wasn't their fault.
Yeah.
That's how the documentaries that featured them would portray them. They would always be, this is a phrase that you're very familiar with. They were always the token skeptic.
Yep.
And they would have no time to speak. So, you know, there would be these tales of all these wonderful paranormal happenings. And it was such an intriguing sort of story. And then you would have the skeptic going, no, it's not real. And then that's it. The rest would be on the cutting room floor from the skeptic. It really did start to be that's what they are. They're grumpy old men. And it's too bad. I mean, I've met both James Randi and Joe Nickel, and they're both fantastic people,
very
funny and full of life. And they're just great to be around. And I think it's a shame that that stereotype is so prevalent.
Yeah, I had the chance to hang around Joe Nickel when I was at DragonCon last, and he is full of fabulous stories. He's really engaging.
Yes. Yeah. Yes, he is.
The Rocky Mountain Paranormal Research Society is one really proactive group because you're even creating videos that you put online in challenge of certain people's claims. Can you tell us about that?
Well, I would say the first real video that we put out was the Alien in the Window video.
Yay!
Which, it gained worldwide fame in a very short amount of time. In fact, the server that's hosting our website is a very large company. And the night that we put it up, the following night, I was on Larry King Live.
Wow.
And everybody started hitting that video. And needless to say, the site was knocked down because of the over a million hits we received that night.
That's fantastic.
And It was crazy. But what had happened is there was a gentleman by the name of Stan Romanek, who we had been following for probably 6 years at that point. And he claims to have the most documented alien abduction story ever in history. Apparently, he didn't know too much about Billy Meyer, because I think Billy Meyer has actually the most documented story that's already been debunked several times. Mm. But Stan Romanek, you know, seemed fairly harmless to us. I mean, we watched him and he was a complete fraud. We knew what he was doing. We would attend his lectures and be able to see right through the sham. But the only people he was talking to were just other people in the UFO community that were already believers. They were already conspiracy theorists and the governments are all horrible and hiding the truth from us. And and all the typical stuff. So there's really no reason to take him down at that point because he stayed within his own, and they weren't going to be convinced anyway by us. So we just kind of sat on it and watched him. Well, one day he gets someone attending his lecture that gets quite frightened by the fake video of an alien looking in the window. And he decides that he's going to create an ET Affairs Commission in Denver, Colorado. So he gets it. He tries to get it put on the ballot, and he's going to make a big press announcement. And the press can come and watch this video. And it's definitive proof. It is the smoking gun to show that aliens are here among us. And this is why we need this commission. So on the night before he's going to do this, it becomes big news. We hear about it. And we hear that this video cannot be faked because it's so perfect and organic looking. And it would take a studio $50,000 to fake this. And so what we did is we immediately knew which video he was talking about. You know, he was trying to be very tight-lipped about everything, but we knew exactly what he was talking about. So we went out, we rented an alien from a costume shop, and we put the whole thing together, including the website. We replicated several other pieces of Stan Romanek's evidence, several other videos he's got, and we did it all in one night for $90. Jeez. And that's including the cost of the domain name, that's the alien rental, that's everything.
Even the coffee for everyone after it's all done.
Exactly, exactly. Wow. It was just, that was it. And like I said, by the next day, it was huge news. When you compare the two videos side by side, ours is actually far superior to his.
And that's the important thing. You got to show them how to do it. Yeah.
Exactly. If you want to fake something, come to us.
Now, there's the serious side of this, because you've mentioned that this has created fear and worry amongst members of the public. And since that time, you've had a little bit more worry in regards to how politics and UFO belief have crossed over. How serious is it getting over there in Denver?
Well, it is a pretty serious thing for all of the paranormal in general. Mm. People tend to be so ready to leap to a paranormal explanation because of the amount of it that's on TV. It's being accepted as fact. You see a bug crawl across a security camera, and it's a ghost. And it's being shown as news on CNN. Mm. You've got, some backwoods idiots in Georgia that basically shove a gorilla costume in a cooler and say that they've got a decaying carcass of Bigfoot. And it's news. Nobody's trying to debunk it of these journalists. None of them are trying to debunk it. They're just presenting this is news. A Bigfoot has been found. And then we have the ranchers that get the mutilated cattle. And it's like the aliens are here. You know, the only expert they got was a UFO believer that said, well, this cattle mutilation could not have been a human and it couldn't have been a predator. The only thing that's left is aliens.
Yeah. And that's why the paranormal research group becomes more and more important as a opportunity for the media to contact.
Absolutely. I mean, because what kind of an asinine statement is that? You've got three choices: humans, predators, and aliens, and simply because he says so, it couldn't be the first two, although there are many other possibilities. So it's really disappointing to see how the media is handling this. They're just looking for sensationalism. So the people are really on edge. You know, they're believing what they're seeing on TV. We get phone calls in the middle of the night because the demon that is chasing around Ryan on Paranormal State is now in their house tormenting them because they just watched an episode of Paranormal State and they know that that demon is in their house too. And then you've got the huge number of paranormal teams that are being spawned from this. When Rocky Mountain Paranormal was started, there were three teams in the Denver area. There are now well over 140, and jeez, they are running around. Yeah, they're running around terrifying people. We get the phone call at 3 in the morning. We're so sorry we didn't call you first. This other team was in our house, and they say we have demons, and then they just left. We don't know what to do.
Oh, man.
So we're running around putting out fires. And it's really sad to watch this happen, but we're working hard to educate the public. We do a lot of lectures for school kids. Teachers are smart enough to bring us in to give lectures about it and to understand that what they're seeing on TV is not necessarily real, and maybe they ought to think twice about what they see and what they're told. And it's we do see it having an impact, so we're very happy about that.
I can see a lot of organization in this, and obviously a lot of community outreach and planning in order to make yourselves these sorts of people who can be contacted. How easy is it to become contacted by the media?
The media really, well, of course, they love to contact us when it gets around Halloween.
Ah.
And I know that Halloween isn't as big in Australia, but it is ridiculous here in America.
It's a big money earner, isn't it, for a start?
Oh,
all the costumes.
Very much so. Yes, very much so. It has become the opportunity for adults to really behave like children. And which is great. I love the idea of that. And Halloween always used to be my favorite holiday because I got to behave as much like a child as I possibly could. Now that I'm a paranormal researcher, I don't get to do that anymore. I would say for the entire month of October and most of November, we are working constantly, doing media appearances and trying to put a stop to a lot of what's going on. And the media loves us around this time of year. So we do get contacted quite a bit more than we used to. So we're on TV quite a bit.
What sort of things can make you stand out and you would suggest to others might consider?
Well, one thing that maybe at first will seem counterintuitive, but one of the things we do is we make darn sure everybody knows that there are no experts.
And that's a very good point.
That's us included. There are absolutely no experts. But what they do need to do is stop. Don't listen to what anybody is saying and just take it on blind faith. Well, what they need to do is stop and think about it twice. Think about what other possibilities there are. We try to show them that there's sort of a graph in front of them. And what they have, what the graph represents is, say, a paranormal claim. Now, on the right side of this graph is the most obvious solution. It is Occam's razor. It's the simplest solution. On the left side of the graph is the paranormal explanation. And there's tick marks all the way down it. You cannot jump to the paranormal explanation. You have to start down at the simple end and eliminate the possibilities. And when you cannot eliminate a possibility, that's where you stop. You do not just automatically jump all of the possibilities and choose paranormal for the explanation. And this is the route that most people are not going. You have to, the paranormal can only be the explanation when everything else has been eliminated. And all you're left with is that as a solution. Or an explanation. But nobody's doing that. They're just jumping right to the paranormal explanation. So that's one of the things we really try to teach people. In terms of our expertise, we have all sorts of different things in our backgrounds. I'm a computer expert and both hardware and software. I'm also an audio engineer and a producer. A lot of video expertise, along with photography. I've been trained to do EMF field surveys, a lot of things in those areas. I've done a lot of research on world religions, different beliefs, metaphysical beliefs. And I think one of the most important ones is that I was a believer at one stage. And that being in that frame of mind and remembering what it was like really helps me to identify with what these people are going through. And it does make a big difference. Now Brian, he's a photography expert, teaches Photoshop classes, trained to do electromagnetic field surveys, We both have certifications with thermal cameras, which is why we know that they're worthless in this field. And you know, it's just we both have a pretty wide range of certifications and education in related fields. So, you know, almost any field can be related. Even if you're a plumber, it can come in handy.
Okay, watch out for that. If you start going down the line of the plumbers, oh no.
But it's true. I mean, being a plumber is actually a good credential to have for this type of investigation. But it has to be part of what you do. I mean, you have to take in the things that you know as a plumber. You need to be able to use that knowledge. You know, if you hear a familiar sound and you know that sound because it's the sound of a bracket not being on a pipe correctly, then that's something you can solve immediately because of your experience as a plumber. And there are a lot of things like that, that when you're dealing with people's residences, that being a plumber is very handy. But if you're not using critical thought, then it doesn't matter what your profession is. You're going to give idiot responses no matter what. You know, if it's any sort of technical field, the odds are you're going to be able to use the knowledge in some way. And that's a great start because then it gives you that sort of procedural mindset that if you think about all of your tools for what they were originally designed for, rather than looking at them as ghost hunting tools. You know, you don't use a camera as a ghost hunting tool. It is a documentation tool. Audio recording is not a ghost hunting tool. It's a documentation tool. So you really get into the mindset of documenting things to find the truth rather than running out with your ghost detector.
Now, speaking of people detecting things which might not be there, Jeff Peckman, I've read about him. Back in 2008, he created a extraterrestrial affairs commission in Denver. How has that continued on since that time?
Well, Jeff Peckman needed to get 4,000 signatures to get his ET Affairs Commission on the City of Denver ballot to be voted on that year. He has failed every time to get the needed number of signatures. He would usually get around 300 or 400 of the 4,000 that he needed.
It's still a significant number, isn't it, though? People saying we need to investigate aliens as part of our public policy.
Well, let me read you just a very quick quote that was just sent. Now, first off, I have to tell you that he ended up hiring a company to acquire the signatures. And this company acquired over 10,000 signatures, most of which were invalid.
Just as so well,
They were thrown out. So he just barely squeaked by with the number of signatures he needed. But then we get this very interesting email that says, I was asked in a deceptive manner. The signature gatherer asked me to sign a petition to put a public safety measure on the ballot. People who don't read the text might sign it, thinking they're doing a good thing. And then the question is, do you think you'd sign it if it had been posed to you in a deceptive manner? Now, a response was, I guess it depends on the ballot question. I tend to think, or I tend to at least scan the full title of the text whenever I'm going to be signing. If I had read it and saw something like this, I would have laughed my ass off and still signed it.
Wow.
So people are signing this because they think it's a funny joke.
Oh, it's like voting for Jedi as your religion. Yeah.
Exactly. So this is the problem, is people are just laughing it up. This is great fun. This is really hilarious. Well, surprise, it's not. This is something that could really damage Denver and set a dangerous precedent for other nut jobs in other cities that want to start something like this. So people need to start taking this seriously and vote no on this. But what are you going to do? I mean, Jeff Peckman is not being taken seriously by a lot of people. In fact, I noticed that the young skeptics there in Australia voted him number 6 on the biggest enemies of skepticism.
he's willing to do things like put up signs and create groups in order to devote a lot of time and money to proving the existence of aliens. That was what I had discovered about him.
Well, he does put forth a lot of effort. His real big thing is that he wants control of a government website, because that's basically what this commission is going to do, is have a website that's going to be exposing the truth. Now, their version of the truth is about as far from reality as you can get, but that version of the truth is going to be on a government website.
Ah.
And that's very dangerous in itself.
Mm. How is it being challenged? Obviously, getting out the message in regards to his actions. What else is being done?
Well, are you speaking from our perspective on what we're doing? Or
Yes, absolutely. What's the Rocky Mountain Paranormal Research Society trying to do in response to this?
Well, we have basically a plan that falls into different phases. And right now we're starting off with just smaller things. Everywhere that he posts any of his stories or whatever, we always have a very thorough debunking of what he said or explanation of what he said in the comments section. So it's just a very small thing at the moment. We are putting together a political organization that will be recognized by the city of Denver. So we will be able to demand equal time from anyone that gives him any time. And so we're going that route. We're also filming anti-Peckman, I guess you would say, commercials, videos, things like that. In fact, we're trying to come up with some acronyms for this political organization. And I'm going to run just a few of them by you to see what you think.
Okay, go for it.
We've got Citizens Rejecting Asinine Proposals, which is otherwise known as CRAP.
Yes.
We've got Citizens Helping Unmask Manipulative Megalomaniacal Proposals, which is CHUMP.
Yep,
and then we've got Mission for Inhibiting Bureaucracy, which is the MIB. I like that one a lot.
Oh, I like the MIB. That sounds good.
Yeah.
It's got a nice cultural clip.
Yeah, I think that's the one we're going to go for. And then we got Citizens Rejecting Eccentric Extraterrestrial Proposals, otherwise known as CREEP. And then we've got Citizens of the Lizard Overlord Nation, otherwise known as Colon.
That might get the wrong idea. However, I'm certain that maybe a few plumbers might be intrigued by that saying. We can help you out with that.
We're trying to come up for one for probe. But all we can come up with so far is people rejecting, and we haven't got the rest of it yet. But so I think the MIB is probably what we'll go with on that one.
Yeah.
But in the end, we're compelled to do it, and we do have a lot of fun, especially when we're successful. And we've had enough success as of late that we'll be doing this for quite some time.
That is so cool. And you make a difference, which is wonderful, getting that feedback and saying –
It really is. There's nothing better than getting – we get emails from people that we've managed to change their lives. And those are the most important trophies that we'll ever get. And so it's we've had some very interesting ones in that sense. So I'm very, very happy about that.
Now, as a result of all of this work – a lot of dedication. I've heard that you've got an actual television show in the process of happening. Can you tell us a little about that?
Well, we've actually got the potential of two different television shows.
Not one, but two. That's great.
Yes, there's one that's a local show that we're working on called Colorado X, Case Files of the Paranormal. And what that is, it's an interesting show where we have a team of skeptics and academics who are doing the investigations with us, and we are the paranormal team. So we go in and we use our particular skeptical approach to doing it, and then they do theirs, and then at the end of the show we have a consensus on what we found. So that's one show that we're doing that we'll probably stay fairly local. We'll probably have some webisodes on the website and stuff. But the other one doesn't have a name as of yet. But it is by the production company that Warren Miller, part of. So, and he is the wonderful director that does a lot of the ski films and actually has offices in Australia as well as America and other places. And they do incredible extreme, like winter sports type of documentaries and shows. And they've decided they want to branch out and do something more along the lines of Penn and Teller's BS and Mythbusters and things like that, but have it very focused on the paranormal.
So and maybe extreme skepticism. You're chasing the aliens on skis, perhaps.
Yes, yes. There'll be a lot of jumping out of helicopters with snowboards and EMF detectors.
Getting ready for the Olympics, I imagine, yeah, and taking part in that. That'll be fun.
Exactly. So that'll be very exciting. But we will be doing a lot of exposing frauds.
Fabulous.
That's going to be one of the number one things about this show. We will be tackling the frauds and really making them fess up as much as we can. But it's going to be exciting. I'm going to catch them red-handed.
Fantastic. That is brilliant. Now, if people would like to keep an eye on what you're up to or ask some questions, because I think you are a fabulous resource for someone who might be wanting some direction because you have so many things that you've achieved, what are the best sites to...
Well, the main website to go to is RockyMountainParanormal.com. Mm-hmm. And that website has an incredible wealth of information and all-around craziness on it. And from that site, you'll also find links to our online magazine or our digital magazine called Modern Paranormal Investigator. And then the radio show is warningradio.info. And there's also links off of the Rocky Mountain Paranormal site. We're also doing another site called Rocky Mountain Paranormal Labs. And we will be posting results from more scientifically based experimentation on, I'll say, the paranormal community's accepted ghost tools, such as the Frank's Box, the Ovilus, the Paranormal Puck, all these really stupid devices that people are using to catch ghosts with. We're actually going to be putting them through scientific testing with a local university here in Colorado. And then we'll be posting the results on RockyMountainParanormalLabs.com. And just to give people a little more insight on what these devices really do.
Fantastic. So, thank you so much for talking to us, Baxter, here on the Skeptic Zone.
Thank you so much.
We take you now to a conversation being shattered across a hillside.
What?
I said I'm trying to come up with a promo for this podcast.
What podcast?
The Geologic Podcast.
What?
The Geologic Podcast.
Oh, Harab's pointless meanderings, skeptical observations, ridiculous musical interludes, and not a hint of geology.
Well,
all right, maybe a little bit of geology, but it's not worth it.
Come on, he's got the religious moron of the week. Geo's mom reads Jay-Z lyrics.
Pointless.
Ask George.
Who cares what the bastard thinks?
Interesting fauna.
Oh, great.
The horoscopes.
Garbage.
Not the Bible.
Boring garbage.
Misinformed science.
Stupid garbage.
True adventures of the Philadelphia Funk Authority.
Ooh, white Ukrainian boy playing drums in a funk band. Must be fascinating.
But none of that is appealing.
Not even a wee bit.
Great. Don't tune in then.
I won't.
Fine.
Fine.
Great.
Great.
Fine.
Great.
Great.
You said that already.
The Geologic Podcast. Pointless, but free. GeologicPodcast.com.
Hi, I'm Dr. Stefan Soyka for Médecins Sans Médecine, or Doctors Without Medicine. Médecins Sans Médecine is an alternative therapies crisis response organization. Our dedicated team of fully certified healers from a diverse range of disciplines, like iridology, color therapy, aura balancing, and ear candling, are on hand 24/7 around the globe to deal with natural disasters such as the devastating earthquake in Haiti, the Indian Ocean tsunami of 2004, or man-made disasters such as the horrific conflicts in Afghanistan, Congo, and the Niger Delta. Most of you would have already heard of Médecins Sans Frontières, but their so-called medicine is simply not enough. Médecins Sans Médecine provides alternative, complementary healthcare to the crushed, stabbed, shot and tortured. The first thing we do when we enter a disaster zone is a patient caregiver consultation. For $300, we take a multidisciplinary approach to triage to ensure a full and accurate diagnosis. Patients are usually brought to us in a terrible state, so the first thing we do is pray to the great Archangel Raphael for the patient's speedy recovery. We then move into some Eastern healing chanting, invoking the full spectrum of spirit beings to comfort and protect the victim. A magical white light of well-being is then cast upon the bleeding and battered subject, covering any leaking chakras and plugging any aura holes with a protective spiritual spack filler. If possible, we then turn the patient immediately on their side and perform an emergency ear candling to eliminate any toxins that might have entered the body through the gaping wounds and or bullet holes. It is essential during such emergency response treatments to use ear candling drip wax protectors to avoid piercing the chakra-protecting white light capsule. Triage is complete after a full homeopathetic, iridological, psychic, mind-body herbal report is created on some aromatherapy-infused rainbow-coloured paper with affirmations at the bottom, documenting the full extent of the victim's wounds and ailments. They might also, through remote viewing, provide psychic information about their friends and relatives in neighbouring villages, where we might even solve a few unsolved crimes of the last 500 years. A typical triage patient would present with muscle tightness, tiredness, low energy levels, or a sluggish liver in need of a good cleansing. Typically, as well, their bodies, limbs, and skulls would be riddled with shrapnel, with gaping wounds down to the bone, or even partially dismembered. At this point, the Médecins Sans Médecine complementary health practitioners would go into full ER mode, with our patented field hospital homeopathy kit, scrapings of the wound giving shrapnel, or in the case of the Haitian earthquake victims, ground up concrete bricks, would be diluted down to extreme healing levels, instilling in the water the total memory of the bomb or building collapse that caused the ailment, drawing the healing power of the body out through a powerful, miraculous, yet impossible to scientifically demonstrate homeopathetic action. Through sheer serendipity, the water we use in such disaster areas is usually also riddled with botulism, cholera, E. coli, typhoid and salmonella, so we can treat a whole range of diseases with a one single remedy. From homeopathy, we move to acupuncture, often gaining direct access to the qi meridians via the open wounds, which only magnifies the effect on the patient, as is clearly noticeable in their facial expressions. We then install magnetic bracelets on whatever remaining limbs there are, and that magnetic healing is again magnified through any metallic objects that are still lodged within our client. It is often at this time that the whole family of our customer comes into the Médecins Sans Médecine Crystal Marquee to join us in prayer to as many angels as we can think of. At this critical moment in the patient's destiny, a full tarot reading and astrology star chart is done. If the patient is still alive, they are moved to the Reiki lounge where our Reiki masters peel back the white light energy orb and channel universal healing power right where it's needed, at the spurting severed arteries. Then it's time for a full detox with 1-2-3 gut flush and the application of the LifeWire healing wand at any exit wounds. A bit of aromatherapy, a couple of drops of bark flower remedy under the tongue, and the Médecins Sans Médecine healing process is complete. Although we are swimming in cash from billing all our treatments directly to the patient's families in US dollars, guaranteed by the World Health Organization, we do ask for your support to let Médecins Sans Médecine continue our vital work in the world's disaster areas. Don't trust the health of millions of victims of war, disaster and famine to Médecins Sans Frontières, who rely solely on science and medicine and are nothing more than a marketing arm of the big pharmaceuticals. At Médecins Sans Médecine, we don't need medicine. We need faith, magic, and a shitload of money to get the job done.
Thank you for listening to this episode of The Skeptic Zone, which I got to you through the skin of my teeth. Or via the skin of my teeth? How many teeth does a chicken have? Something like that. It's one of those days, folks. It's one of those days. Until next week, this is Richard Saunders, signing off from Sydney, Australia.
You've been listening to The Skeptic Zone. Visit our website at www.skepticzone.tv for comments, contacts, and extra video reports. The Skeptic Zone.